So, good morning again. We have a very important topic to deal with. Successful transition from sheltered employment settings into the open labor market. Let's start with a short introduction. Who is sitting here? Who are the panelists? So everybody should introduce himself or herself and tell whom you are representing. Let's start with me. I'm Klaus LACHWITZ from Germany. I'm a human rights lawyer, and for more than 30 years I worked as a legal advisor for parents with intellectual disabilities and their sons and daughters and self-advocates, because my wife has a sister with intellectual disability and they are very close friends. Well, and after my retirement as a lawyer, I was elected as president of Inclusion International, which is the global association representing more than 200 member organizations in 115 countries. And I was asked by the International Disability Alliance to represent them here, because there I am the Secretary General. That's my introduction, and now I refer to the people from Vermont, United States of America. Mm-hmm.
Thank you. My name is Bryan Daigue. I'm with the University of Vermont, Center on Disability and Community Inclusion of the United States, Vermont.
Good afternoon. My name is Lisa CULBERTSON. I represent Vermont's Department of Aging and Independent Living. And I am a director of employment at Upper Valley Services, serving individuals with intellectual disabilities.
Get the drinks off. Good morning. I'm Elizabeth Seitler. I'm the executive director of Champlain Community Services, which is the last sheltered workshop to close in Vermont. And I'm also here representing the state of Vermont's Department of Aging and Independent Living.
Good afternoon, everybody. My name is Ceracela Nicoleta Predescu, and I am the executive director of a Romanian NGO called PROAC Support, who delivers social services for people with intellectual disabilities.
Hi, everyone. My name is Irad. I'm from Israel. I represent Shekulo Tov, an Israeli NGO, and I live in a kibbutz. Thank you.
Okay. Hello. My name is Andreas Jesse. I come from Austria, and I'm the managing director from autArk. autArk offers social services.
Good afternoon. My name is Karin Astecker. My colleague Alfred Leitner and I will represent Lebenshilfe Salzburg, which is an Austrian service provider for persons with intellectual disability operating in the Salzburg region. Alfred and his team, they set up and implemented the approach we will share with you today, and I'm responsible for research and development and international cooperation in our organization.
Thank you for this introduction. Now we have altogether six statements, and we have asked each speaker to limit the statement to between 6 and 8 minutes, because afterwards we want to include you, the audience. You can comment and you can have questions to us. So I will start with my statement, and I think what is important and a really important message is that the unemployment rate of persons with disabilities is extremely high worldwide. We have just learned that in the European Union, about 18% of all people in the working age, people with disabilities, 18% are unemployed. In the comparison, only 9% of the average people are unemployed in Europe. So it's the double figure. And what is not included in this figure is how many people are really working in sheltered workshops and comparable settings, and how many people worldwide still live in big institutions without personal rights, because many of these institutions are administrated by directors who have the full guardianship over these people. That's an amazing thing and a very sad thing, I would say. Anyway, there are no trustful data available about the figures we have on sheltered workshops. The reason for that is that these sheltered workshops and comparable settings are so different. The national social laws behind these workshops are not identical. So we compared, for instance, in Europe, sheltered workshops in Germany and in Belgium, in France, etc., etc. In some of these sheltered workshops, you have employee statues, in others you don't have. In some of these workshops, you have security, in others you don't have any kind of social security. Then sometimes you receive a minimum wage, sometimes it's only pocket money. So the figures are very, very poor. Let me just give you some examples about the situation in my own country. In Germany, we have 680 sheltered workshops all over Germany. And after reunification of both parts of Germany in 1989, 150 new sheltered workshops were built and erected in the eastern parts of Germany. This was happening before the CRPD was adopted, but it shows that the development is still in favoring sheltered institutions. We have 260,000 persons with intellectual disabilities, psychosocial disabilities, and multiple disabilities working in these workshops. Well, how do we try to transfer at least some of them to the open and inclusive labor market? All of us have discussed supported employment. What I want to add is that supported employment is not automatically in line with Article 27 of the CRPD. The criteria described in this article are of utmost importance. They prescribe that each worker has the right to work on an equal basis with others. Equal basis means in comparison to non-disabled people. Each worker has a right to gain its living. Each worker has a right to choose where to work and to accept the work. And finally, the final criteria of Article 27 reads, each worker is entitled to work in the open labor market. So you see, even if we discuss supported employment, we have to be very, very careful. My final example how we try to deal with these questions in Germany is we have a so-called new personal budget for work. So instead of going in a sheltered workshop, you can apply for such a budget. And then you receive the money, which usually is paid directly to the workshop. You receive that money yourself. But you can spend it only to an employer who finds, because he needs a wage subsidy in order to employ you, and you need a job coach and an assistant. So this money is used to spend it to the employer in order to convince him that it's worthwhile to sign with you a contract. And I think the budget is about 75% of the usual salary paid to the other workers. So we hope this will be a success, but it will work only if these usually young people work together, and they must try to cooperate, because it's quite complicated. It's a bureaucratic system behind it, and you need advice and assistance. Well, that's my statement, just to give you some impression what is happening in my country and what is happening in Europe. So the next group is from Vermont. Please start.
Thank you. Oh, here we go. Okay. So the three of us will be co-presenting together as we go through this. I'll kind of cover more of the past, present, and future here. Vermont's policy really stemmed from real values and philosophy from a number of our leaders at the state of Vermont and also at the University of Vermont. We're very fortunate that we are a small state, so we're kind of quick and nimble, and the leaders at the University of Vermont and the state of Vermont just saw that with the advent of supported employment policies, they really wanted to put their efforts into that rather than segregated and sheltered employment. What stemmed from that was a real strong partnership between the University of Vermont, the state of Vermont's Developmental Disability Services, and the state of Vermont's Division of Vocational Rehabilitation. So it was really that strong partnership working together kind of formed services for the state of Vermont. And later on, we still continue to partner with Green Mountain Self-Advocates, a disability persons organization, and then also the community in general. So the fundamental philosophy is really to promote and pay for what we wanted and not to fund or support what was not desired. The state of Vermont did really invested in training and technical assistance through the University of Vermont to assist agencies in developing supported employment programs really guided the funding, blended funding, so that it ensured that it would support community-based employment and not segregated employment. Then over the years, just really looked at spending the money on community-based services and eliminating funding segregated services. Our path to inclusion started early on, late 70s, and 1980 was the first pilot project that was developed for supported employment. Gradually started closing sheltered workshops as our supported employment programs grew. The institution closed in 1993, and eventually the last sheltered workshop closed in 2002. Our employment rates gradually increased, and now we're providing support to post-secondary ed programs for students with intellectual disabilities. Next slide. Overall, our employment rate for the state of Vermont for individuals with intellectual and developmental disabilities is 48%. And our national average is 19%.
The impact of these policies and practices have positively benefited both employee and employer. The employee experiences full integration into the economic and social fabric of society. They develop confidence and individuality by engaging in the activities of meaningful employment that we all enjoy. Vermont Supported Employment has promoted awareness in the business community, which has allowed employers to think outside the box to meet their business needs. They come to realize a diverse workforce that enhances creativity and production. Next. Please allow me to introduce Tiffany, whose primary diagnosis is cerebral palsy. She has 26 other diagnosis that is precipitated by this, including an intellectual disability. Tiffany has one consistent motor skill. She uses her head to activate a switch on her chair that plugs into a number of devices that allows her to communicate with others. It also allows her to express her artistic abilities to receive support in creating beautiful abstract paintings. Tiffany wanted to find a way to share these creations with her community. Tiffany partnered with her team, vocational rehabilitation, and local businesses to start Tiffmark Art, a greeting card business. She has cards in four businesses in the community and is in the process of developing a website for greater access. Small businesses are recognized and celebrated all across Vermont. We believe self-employment is a viable option for persons with intellectual disabilities by offering flexibility, creativity, and self-reliance.
Good. And so continuing in the theme of talking about individuals and driving home the point of finding the right work or a career leads to success, we believe that people are most successful when they're in the right work. So I want to introduce Ryan. He's a brilliant, articulate man with autism. He lives in Vermont, in Essex, Vermont, and he found the right work by following his heart. He wanted to work in childcare. It took a lot of effort, though, for Ryan to follow his dream. Michelle Paya, our Director of Supported Employment at Champlain Community Services, worked with him for a year and a half to develop a comprehensive portfolio that is now seen as a standard in Vermont for portfolios for accreditation for becoming child care workers. This led to his accreditation that he has to go back for every few years, and it helped him to become a successful child care worker. He now works 16 to 24 hours a week. 5 years ago, he started at the Lund Family Center, and now, after several years of supported employment, now he works independently, and he's a rich part of the school. When Ryan's not there, the staff miss him, the family asks after him. He's fully integrated into his work. So what's next for Vermont? This is a question that we have a lot. After 15 years of exclusively providing community-based supported employment, as I mentioned earlier, Champlain Community Services, where I'm the director, was the last sheltered workshop to close in Vermont. We've begun to dream about new initiatives and visions for the future. So I just want to quickly focus on two areas, because I know I want to get to my colleagues here. Transition and how agencies can reduce their involvement. The first is we are working to develop developmental interests earlier, meaning we're working with schools to encourage students of all abilities to look at their careers at earlier, and it helps to change the mindset. We're also working with schools and colleges for post-secondary education initiatives. We have several going on in Vermont. I know you've heard some of them here in the conference. It's a very exciting transition, and we're trying to help manage that what can feel like a cliff on graduation from high school when students don't know what to do. Additionally, agencies have developed an online credentialing process or certification. We believe that people who do the direct support of supported employment should be able to do so as a career, that it should be a profession, and so we're working to that effort to make sure that they're paid correctly, to make sure that they're standardized in their education, and we hope that will help move us to the next phase. And finally, we've begun rolling out a pilot program for embedded supports in the workplace, and the idea is to reduce stigma and to develop more natural relationships in the employment arena. So I think I'll stop there. Thank you.
Thank you for that overview. A short question. What is the situation in the United States on the whole in comparison to Vermont? Just to know.
The employment rate, the national rate is 19%, ours is 48%. But we're hoping that nationally it'll move more in that direction, because our Medicaid services is requiring people to be involved more in the community and not in segregated settings. So hopefully those figures will change. Mm-hmm.
Thank you. So our next speaker is Irad Eichler from Israel. I know that you work for persons with psychosocial disabilities, and we are very curious to learn how you deal with that, how you find jobs for them, and what are the problems in your country.
Thank you. hi, everybody. Can you get the presentation up? Perfect. Again, my name is Irad. I'm the founder and chairman of Shekulo Tov. We mostly work with people with mental illness, and today I want to present the integrative unit model that was developed and implemented in the last few years in our organization. It was developed with the cooperation of the Ministry of Health in order to take the sheltered places and make them become or shift them into training centers. trying to switch.
The green.
The green one.
Yes.
Perfect. So let me just give you a scope of our organization. We have 270 employees. We don't get any donations. We don't have any volunteers. Our turnover is $15 million a year. We have two revenue streams. One of them is for our recovery services that we provide, and the second one is from our commercial activities that I will elaborate about them in a minute. We give services to 3,000 people all around Israel, mostly people with mental illness, and 600 of them already already found a job. So basically, I want to tell you today about the integrated unit model, and what we do is focus on placement. That's what's most important, and everything that I'll present in the next few minutes is supporting placement. So everything we do is about placement. We have a joke that someone is coming to get services from us, and the first thing that they will hear is, it's great that you came, when are you leaving? Because we want you out there in the job market. So yeah, people are moving into the integrative model and out and placement. So I want to give you a glimpse into some of our units. All our units were founded and operated by us. When I say operated, I mean that all our service users are basically are the ones that run, working and running in our units. So we have 8 factories, chocolate factory, soap factory, candles factories, and so on. Those products are sold in 70 selling booths that we have all around Israel in shopping malls. 4 coffee shops, a dog walking company with hundreds of clients and 100% client retention, 2 second-hand women clothes shops. The Hive is a graphic studio that design personalized games based on our clients' pictures, images. And Rebooks. Rebooks is the biggest second-hand book in Israel. 12 shops, the Israeli biggest second-hand book website, and 500 bookshelves in different coffee shops, mainly in Tel Aviv and the surrounding. Rebooks is also one of Israel's biggest cultural centers, when we have Israeli best writers coming into our shops and giving talks to our clients. And on the online side, we have a lot of people with a book addiction looking for new books all the time on our website, as we have 400,000 books on our website. So what is it about the integrated model that makes it so successful? The thing is that in the integrated model, which is could be a bookshop or a coffee shop, each person can find their own path. Each person can find their own journey. So we have, you can come into one of our shops and you can see 30 people, but each one of them has their own recovery plan. Each one of them has their own, set their own goals, set their own vision on their personal journey, and each one of them is working daily to find the spark, find what makes them move, what motivates them towards the job market. So I want to elaborate a little bit more about what are the principles of the integrative model that makes it so successful. And the first principle is social meaning. Social meaning means that everything that our service users are doing is got something to do with a social meaning with someone from the community. So if we recommend a book, if we sell a good chocolate, and someone appreciates it in the community, that's what we mean by social meaning, and that's what builds the identity of our service user towards the job market. So think about this event taking place on a beach or in a forest. It will be a different event. So we put a lot of effort in building the right setting to support job placement. So our shops look like any other shop, and our coffee shop looks like any other coffee shop. Everything, all the settings are high-end settings in order to build the self-identity of our service users. Each one of them can build their own recovery plan, whether it's how many hours a day, whether it's how many days a week, whether they want to do customer service or want to do a book, deal with a book, or write on the website, or even manufacture chocolate. Every one of them is choosing the right thing for them. We have three main positions in our team. We have the recovery expert, we have the supported employment expert, and we have the commercial expert, all working together. There's no hierarchy between them, so there's no one goal that is more important than the other. So all of them are working together, supporting the people on their recovery plan and on the recovery journey. We have three main KPIs that we measure. The first one is how long does it take for a person, for a service user, till he finds a job? How long does he use our services? The second one is what is the percentage of the service users that are already placed in the job market? And the third one is how long a person keeps their job. So we focus on job placement. Since I have 1 minute, I will try to... This is a really important principle. So our commercial side is based on just enough sales. That means that we can, in our chocolate factory, we manufacture 50,000 units a month. We can also manufacture and sell 30,000 units a month, but it won't do good for the recovery process because it will put a lot of pressure on our service users. So we, for each one of our units, we have the goal of just enough production or just enough sales in order to make the ecosystem supportive for our service users. Our service is continually supporting our service user as they go along, so we can support a person whether it's on the integrative unit or a supported employment, or even after they want to advance to build their career and find another job, so we still support them. So it's an ongoing process. So in terms of our next step, we have three main goals. First of all, we want to use technology to support the recovery process, and we are now developing an app, a personal app that supports the service users' recovery plans. The second one is working with other disabilities as well, as we started already working with the welfare and the social affair in Israel. And the third one is building a network of professional recovery and vocational recovery professional all around the world, sharing their own best practices. So I want to thank you and thank Project Zero, and I want to mention two of my colleagues that are sitting here and helped building this amazing amazing model, our CEO Ofer Cohen and our CRO, Chief Recovery Officer Agal Alush. Thank you.
Thank you. Our next speaker is Andreas Jesse from Austria, representing Schanzen Forum, and we are curious to learn what is happening in Austria.
Okay, my English is not very good, and therefore my speech, my statement is not very long. And I read my text. Okay, my company offers social services. We have an all-encompassing service package leading to the employment in the open labor market. In this property, we have many projects. And the project I present today is called Chancenforum. The Chancenforum is an offer for the professional integration of people with disabilities in the open labor market in Carinthia. Carinthia is a country in Austria. The goal being to offer opportunities to people with disabilities to work in employment workshops with professional support provided by a specific group of people to help them work on the general, on the open labor market. Therefore, the Chancenforum offers people with disabilities the opportunity of professional integration with professional assistance. Target group are people with disabilities who work in employment workshops are counted as no ability to work. And we say, but these people still have skills and they can work when the conditions are right. And the Chancenforum provides this framework conditions and supports people with disabilities in working of the open labor market. Instead of only employment in workshops, the Chancenforum staff members will obtain gainful employment in a company of the open labor market. Therefore, people with disabilities receive collective payment, not pocket money, as well as their own social insurance. Working hours. An employment in the Chancenforum is usually offered as a part-time position. Generally, it is dependent to the individual's capacity, but can be stretched to between 14 and 19 hours per week. Factor of success number one is a personal assistance for a complete working life. This is a person of my company, a person of the integration service autArk. Factor of success number two is mentoring. There is a direct contact person in every company. This is a person directly from the company where the person with disability works. The factor of success number three are work meetings. At these meetings, work-related topics are discussed. The next success factor is regular training of work-related content. These trainings are barrier-free and need-oriented. For example, easy to understand language. And the last success factor is competence training. Social skills are trained in single settings or in group settings. And so we can say a good and professional collaboration between the personal assistant from autArk, the mentor in the company, and the handicapped person guarantees a successful work on the general labor market. Thank you.
Thank you, your English was very good. So, It was really an interesting statement. We have another speaker from Austria. It's Alfred Leitner, and he's accompanied by you. And go on and start your presentation.
Yeah, so we move on to a different country state. Now we are in the country state of Salzburg in Austria, and to be more precise, in the Flachgau region. And our project is called Flachgau Inclusive, which stands for Inclusive Employment Opportunities for Persons with Intellectual Disability in this region. In our region, usually work opportunities for persons with intellectual disability are limited to sheltered workshops. And the project was developed to overcome these limitations. And it's based on cooperation with local companies and municipalities that provide inclusive work opportunities. People can work in the companies or in the municipalities, or they can work in our service center, which coordinates a broad variety of inclusive work opportunities in the community. So, how does that work? The workshops in the Flachgau regions, they set up this service center, which is coordinating the inclusive work opportunities. And they work with personal future planning, with every single service user. And the service user is in the center of this planning process, but they usually also involve their personal environment. People can work alone or in groups. This group option might be an important step for people who have been working in segregated services for a long time and for whom this direct step into employment in the open labor market might be too quick. Since 2014, persons with disability can work in regular employment, so far all of them part-time. And the staff from our service center assists them with initial integration and guidance, and then usually after some time, a mentor in the company takes over. So, what do we think are important success factors of our approach? We would say that time is very important. Time is needed to build up trust with the local companies and cooperation, and also persons with disability and their families need time to build up trust and to build up confidence for this step. And they need time for trying out different options and for personal development without pressure. And we also think it's very important that we offer a large variety of inclusive work options, not just a small selection of tasks or work environments, but really a big variety, and that we work with step-by-step solutions, meaning starting where the person wants to start and also with the velocity that the person wants to develop. It is essential to define individual solutions through personal future planning or other person-centered planning methods. And we also think it's very important to spread positive examples because this serves to reduce anxieties or insecurities that people might have. And it's really encouraging for all the stakeholders, for the persons with disabilities themselves, for their families, and also for the companies that consider working with us in this way. We brought the success story of Mrs. L because we think that it's illustrating quite well the success factors of this approach. So Mrs. L had been working in specialized services and never had worked in the open labor market. And in our service center, she found many, many options, and she also got the time and the security to develop her own ideas and to develop confidence. And her individual wishes led her to an office job in a company called Teampool. And this office job was in the area of accountancy. And so in the beginning, she needed quite a lot of explanation and guidance that the staff of our service center provided. And nowadays, the main source for information and guidance is her local mentor in the company if she needs guidance. But in fact, Mrs. L feels now very confident and secure and is working very well. And she even already trained herself a new colleague. And Mrs. L's mentor really trusts her, and she thinks she is a great help in the office and a real enrichment to the team. And Mrs. L is very happy and proud because she always wanted to work in a company and so finally was able to achieve this important personal goal. Yeah, so the impact we achieved, we were able to provide inclusive work opportunities also for persons with high support needs. We enabled people to get access to regular employment. Currently, it's 22 people in the Flachgau region who have a contract. And it's not only about employment, but these people got access to a lot of opportunities to participate in the companies and in the communities, social events, which is very important for them. They all experienced the real boost in self-esteem and also in terms of capabilities. And the perception of persons with intellectual disability changed a lot at the workplace and also in the communities, because they are more visible, they participate, they contribute, and their contribution is seen and is valued. So the perceptions of persons with intellectual disability are much more positive. And there were a couple of media reports that spread the approach and that attracted more companies to cooperate with us and also attracted other service providers to copy the approach. So by talking about our methodology and the success factors, we already said a lot about innovative factors, but we also wanted to say that we think it's very important to be courageous, think outside the box, find solutions bypassing the traditional system, and doing that avoid its limitations by laws and regulations and traditional practices. And so we can create realities that eventually also shape the policy level. But we encounter, of course, challenges because of that, as we are somehow bypassing the system. It's usually changes at policy level take a long time. People right now have the risk of losing benefits by employment, even if it's only part-time. And a special commitment is needed by the organization, the staff, and the mentors, because the system doesn't yet provide dedicated resources to build up such an approach. Finally, the next steps. Thank you, dear. Finally, the next steps. So we want to amplify the cooperation network with companies and municipalities. We want to increase the number of persons in regular employment. So Alfred estimates that it will be at least 30 people by 2018. We want to extend the approach to other regions. We already have big cooperation networks there and already also the first successes with regular employment. And we want to develop our approach further on the individual level. If people with the new experiences want to change something, and also on the system level by what we learned. And finally, we want to try to find solutions to avoid or at least reduce the benefit trap. And we want to support persons with disability to secure social embeddedness, because many of them have very small social networks that mostly consist of family and other service users. So that was our approach in short. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you. Our final speaker, can you give us this instrument? Yes. Our final speaker is Zerasela Nicolet from Romania. And Romania is a country which had a lot of big institutions, and we are curious to learn how you try to solve the problems. Thank you.
I will start by saying thank you to the Zero Project for giving me the opportunity to share with you what is PROACT doing in Romania, related very much with deinstitutionalization, By the way, you mentioned about big institution in Romania. So as I mentioned earlier, ProAct is a non-profit, a non-governmental organization who is accredited by the Romanian Ministry of Labor and Social Inclusion to give and to offer services for people with disabilities. I like to say that ProAct is a grassroots organization, and it's mainly focused on promoting the article number 19 from the UN Convention of the Rights of People with Disabilities, the rights to live in the community. And what we are doing, from a total population of 19 million people, we have 700,000 people with disabilities and over 17,000 living in horrible condition in large institution. So we try to get out these people out of the institution and to create community services, community-based services, and to include these people at the level of community. There are many things to be, you know, mentioned about the institution, and you all of you know about this. Horrible places, isolated by the community, somewhere outside of the village or of the town, together, staying together with other 150, 200 people in the same place with no respect for individual needs. Places where people are captive and they are not allowed to go outside because it is too dangerous and they are safe to stay inside. They don't have access to a market. They don't know how to cook. They never go for shopping. They don't have relationship. And what is the worst, they lost any contact with any member of the family. So the task for ProAct, it's very difficult in a country where even if it's, you know, Romania signed the UN Convention and it's mandatory to implement all the articles, it's only on, you know, verbal level. In the implementation, it's much difficult. So I would like also to point out that beside the disability, there is additional stigma. We are talking about Roma people living in institution, we are talking about women, we are talking about people abandoned since birth, who grew up in institution, in several institutions. So this is a reason who scare the employers, because there are too many problems, too many limits, and they don't know how to deal with. And we think there are at least two reasons for this. The first reason would be the lack of interaction of the business sector with people with intellectual disabilities. And the second one, it's very much based on a medicalized view. It is still a medicalized view. People are seeing people with intellectual disabilities as patients, as, you know, limited, as people who need pills. And for these reasons, the employers consider people with intellectual disabilities as troublemakers. So they get scared because they don't know how to provide support for these people. And instead to be involved with, they prefer to stay away. What is ProAct doing, taking in consideration this reality? First of all, it's not just a word. It's really what we believe in. It's about the fact that the person-centered approach is our main philosophy. With other words, we try to put people with intellectual disabilities in normal context of the life, giving them the opportunity to play various roles like contributors, employees, buyers, friends, lover, inhabitant, neighbor. All these make a difference. And I will give you a very specific example from our activity. When he started to open the first community-based service, the community, the neighbors, heard that in danger people will come and it will be extremely complicated for us. We will be in danger. And they made a petition and they wanted to go to the mayor. What we done? Instead of, you know, trying to talk with people, instead of, you know, cutting ribbon, because we like this, when we open a service, we have this fashion of cutting ribbons. So we let things to develop. And they see people with intellectual disabilities going in exactly in the same place in the community, exactly in the same markets, in the, you know, post office, in the bank office, using the same transportation like the other members in the community use. And they started to change their perception and their mentality. And it was a very natural way. In this way, we change a lot the perception of people and the community. I have only 2 minutes. What is different in our model? A very personalized approach. First of all, we are going to really know the person, but not from a specialist to a person with intellectual disability level, from a human being level to another human being level. It is very important to know the person because you can discover the abilities, the capabilities, the skills, what is good in that person, because anyone in this world has potential. And you have to work with this potential to bring at the surface. And then we discover that sometimes you might work to adjust their expectation with what they can really do. It's important to keep the balance. And it might needed, you know, some specialized training, and if not, we are going directly for employment. We employ people on the open labor market. We also employ people, fewer people in protected units, but it's important to mention that we do not have protected units only for people with intellectual disabilities. There are people always from the community. So there is a combination between people with intellectual disabilities as well as people from the community. And in such cases, the employers are very flexible and they have knowledge about people with intellectual disabilities. And the last one, it's we created our own small enterprises because we realize we have people with severe intellectual disabilities who are not able right now to live on the labor market. So what we are going to do with these people? We created a workshop and then soon realized it's not enough. And then we were forcing to think what to do to give a meaningful activities to these people, not just to pretend they spend their time. So we created two greenhouses and a small turkey's farm. And people are employed, they are doing meaningful activities, they have high self-esteem, and they are included. And one last word, I just wanted to point out that employment, it's only one piece in our activities because we are working with adults who spend their entire life in institution, who are 20, 30, 40, 50, and we started from the beginning with, you know, how to live in the community, how to know your neighbors, how to be presented, how to develop your relationships. So accommodation, relationships, any education, any other areas which proact support, provide support, and serve people with intellectual disabilities. Thank you very much.
Thank you all for this fantastic overview, and give them a hand, please. Well, we have some time left, 20 minutes, so we want to give the audience a chance to speak up and to comment. And finally, the panelists will have the chance to summarize what they have learned from that session here. Let me, in short, add something. We have learned very positive examples. But worldwide comparison shows that persons with intellectual disabilities and psychosocial disabilities still belong to the poorest of the poor in many parts of the world. There are studies from Human Rights Watch which show that there are big institutions in horrible conditions in parts of Africa, in Ghana, in the Philippines, in Mexico, etc. So I think we have to fight to change that. And what is interesting to learn is what the United Nations think about that problem, what they think about sheltered workshops, etc. There's an interesting study which was published in 2012 by the UN High Commissioner for Human Rights. And in this study, he really claims to close down sheltered settings in the next years and to replace them by supported employment mechanism. And we have the United Nations Committee on the Rights of Persons with Disabilities. And this committee has really carefully checked many countries now, because the countries are obliged to send their reports, what is happening at national level. And they have found out that in many, many parts of the world, either persons with intellectual disabilities and psychosocial disabilities are still unemployed, or the majority works in sheltered settings. So they published their so-called concluding observations on these reports, and if you study these concluding observations, you always find the hint there are too many sheltered workshops and you should close them down. And what is mentioned in nearly all of these observations is that women are more disadvantaged than men. So I think there's a gender problem too, which we should always consider. Okay, now you are free to comment and to ask questions. If you have questions, please direct them to the panelists you want to ask. Then it's much easier to get the answers. Who wants to start? Over there, there, two, three. I think we should start with four. So the man there is the first one. The light is not very convenient, so try.
Okay.
You get a microphone.
Thank you. My name is Tobias Schoenflug. I'm from Austria, and my question goes out to Mr. Eichler and Ms. Predescu. I find it very impressive and very honorable that you build up businesses on your own. But as you act on the open market, the question of pops up with competitors. How do you see competitors, and how do competitors see your businesses?
You want to answer? Yeah. I think we should answer directly.
Thank you for your question. The way we look at, in terms of competitors, the way we look at it is basically business-wise. We look at the advantage that we give or we bring to our clients. We look for a special value and we compete in the market. We have two advantages. We have a marketing advantage. Still, it's a 100% social product, which gives us advantage in terms of marketing. And the second one is that we don't have this quota of manufacture. As I said, we do just enough. So in terms of, for example, it's easy to sell 1,500 chocolate units as opposed to 100,000 chocolate units. So that's I think, two main things that makes the difference. But you should always look at the product as a product. You need to focus on bringing a value to your client. No one will buy from you the second time if it's just a social product. You need to focus on the value to the customer. So we see that we have, in some of our businesses, as I mentioned, we have 100% client retention. That means by dog walking, think about it, about a dog walking company. People are giving us access to their homes. They trust us with their pet, which they love most, and still they don't leave us. That means that we bring them a lot of value in terms of the commercial side of it. Thanks.
You go. I couldn't remember if it was to me or to someone else.
Ms. Pedescu said in the ad that they also build up three companies. So.
Yes, I mentioned that we set up two greenhouses and one turkey firm. I think in Romania there is enough place for everybody. We are at the very beginning with deinstitutionalization and employing people with intellectual disabilities. If we initially started just to cover the cost of our services with food, you know, provided by these three enterprises, later we started to sell the products, which are good, sustainable, organic products. In fact, the demand is higher than what we produce, and our plan for the future is to expand all these agricultural activities, which are located in rural area, and they are fitting perfectly in the area we are developing these services.
You over there.
Thank you. Jim Crow from European Association of Service Providers. It's often said that the staff in sheltered workshops may be well-intentioned, but may be as institutionalized as the people that they're supporting. And I just wondered if any of the panelists had a reaction or a strategy for dealing with that in their initiatives.
You want to?
Okay. Thank you. That's an excellent question. When we were closing our sheltered workshops, as Bryan was talking about earlier, one of the biggest reasons for the success was a philosophical change statewide. So it included the government, the nonprofit agencies, and the agreement from the people who had worked in the sheltered workshops. Vermont is a small state. We have about 600,000 people. Sometimes that were criticized that we were successful in closing sheltered workshops because it must be easy because it's small. It wasn't easy because it was small, and I am answering your question. But what that means for Vermont is that a lot of the staff that worked in the sheltered workshop have now transitioned along with the community philosophy, along with the individuals who we serve into a supported employment model. So that change has been successful. We all grow up.
Okay, thank you for the question. I can answer long answer and a short answer. I will choose the short one. In essence, what we do is, first of all, we measure the KPIs and we incentivize the team as well as the service user to move on and to find a job. That's the first thing. The second thing is that we're working in the last few months is basically we built what we called an hybrid organization. That means that our service users are becoming part of the organization, taking seats in our meetings and in our and also in interviews. So anyone that starts working in our organization is interviewed by one of our service users, and that breaks the hierarchy between the service users and the service providers, and makes us all focus on the same goal. Thank you.
Thanks, Jim, for the question. I just consulted with Alfred, and in fact, he says that his team has changed the way of working very much, and that that was necessary to set up this approach. Remember that I was talking about the challenges, because we are sidestepping the traditional system. So, I mean, it was necessary for Alfred to really motivate his team to have them on board to really want the development, because actually by setting up the project, all of them were contributing personal time and efforts to it and not only paid time. And so Alfred says that the most important thing was to have the goal in mind, that the impact that they wanted to achieve, that they were all convinced that it was very positive and possible to have persons with intellectual disability and high support needs in the communities, and so that they all work together on these goals and that they enjoyed the development also step by step. that's kind of the...
There was a lady over there, yes.
Hi, my name is Marna. I'm from the Living Link, a supported employment organization in South Africa. I have a question to the Vermont team. I think what you've done is remarkable, but I'm just wondering about the service users who for years have gone to sheltered workshops. How did you prepare them for this transition to the open labor market? And then are there a portion of those former service users who went to sheltered workshops who are now unemployed still or waiting to be placed? Just to understand the transition plan, because this was, of course, a major years project, I suppose. Thank you.
Well, it was years in the process, and it's been 15 years since our last sheltered workshop closed down. But in the initial stages, just the belief that everybody has value and can work, and then we just found placements that would work for them. So there wasn't sort of the pre-vocational training, just sort of getting people the jobs and then providing them the support that they needed. So that model was effective. But in terms of the last sheltered workshop, there was resistance from people and from families into going out into the community. But the best remedy for that was just showing the successes. Once people got out in the community, it was an example for others. One particular gentleman was particularly opposed to the workshop closing down until he got a job out in the community, and then he got to go back and say, "Well, I've got a job," and then he sort of motivated other people to want to go out and get a job.
I would add that Vermont really values using regular employer trainings for people. I've heard a lot of transition models that, people transition into training modules. We very much value the natural settings of the businesses. And so we look to the businesses to train people so that they can transition well into those companies.
Hi, I'm Judith Bart, Light for the World. I was just triggered by the Israeli case where you said we work and provide enough work for people to cope with it. How do they then cope with it when they transition to a regular position where the workload is not just enough?
Thank you for your question. When I say just enough, I mean in the unit perspective, not in the personal perspective. In the personal perspective, we build their own recovery plan, and they take more and more tasks for themselves, getting themselves ready for the job market. That's our expertise, to manage the group priorities in order to make just enough to sell, but to still fit to everyone's personal plan. Thanks.
Hi, I'm coming from Turkey. I asked to EICHLER. Yes. Okay. Creating budget is very important for us. We are an association, so your model is very interesting. I wonder about how you start, how you open your first factory. The opening a factory is not an easy thing. From where did you find the capital? Did you find a grant or incentives from government or a family? I don't know. Could you please share your tips?
Yes, I will. If you don't mind, I will not answer about the money, because the money, you can find the money, I think it's dependent on the regulation, and you can get donation, you can get from all the places that you spoke about. I think when you look at a place to open, there are two main things that you should look at. The first thing is the business case. You need to make, related to my previous answer, you need to search for a real value, for a real market value for your clients, as opposed to the service users. So that's the first thing. You need to really find a business opportunity. And the second one is that the business opportunity serves the recovery plan or the rehabilitation plan that you want to build, that you want to work with. So, because if you would find the opportunity, the business opportunity will build to build websites, but it's too far away from the abilities of the people that you work with. It won't serve your recovery, your rehabilitation plans. So two things: business wise, and then the supporting recovery. Thank you.
There's time for one comment, perhaps, and then we want to change to the panelists. Do I see anybody? No. So we can summarize, and my suggestion is that each of you has 1 minute to tell us what he has learned from that session and what you expect in the future and what you recommend to do at national level in the future to improve the situation. Perhaps we start with Vermont and then we go over there. 1 minute each.
Well, I think part of it is, in terms of the success, is just getting people out in the community so that they're seen. You know, if people are institutionalized or the community's not used to them. And what we're seeing in Vermont is that, you know, because over the years, you know, we don't have the institutions or workshops anymore, so people are in the community, they're seen, the community sees them and accepts them, and the employers are increasingly seeing them and accepting them. So I think it kind of, you know, builds, you know, once people are out there and they're not institutionalized.
Okay. Even if it seems like a conflict in concepts, I would like a normalization of disability in Romanian society. And then something more general. Do not lose your hope. Be human and fight for your values.
Thank you. So I think I'll try to highlight what I think was not working in the sheltered places, and that's what will make a difference if you wanna help people find their own journey and help them find a job. So the first thing, I think, is a meaningful activity and meaningful for the person itself. So focus on the person and focus on what is meaningful for them. And the second thing is the integration and the communication with the community. Do something that means something to someone else, not just for your service user. And the third thing is focusing on job placement. That's the story, job placement. The sheltered place, the workshops, our integrative unit, everything, it's just serving job placement and not serving itself. Thank you.
My message is more people must from sheltered workshops in the open labor market, and so from pocket money to collective payment and to own social insurance.
And you, finally.
So Alfred and I were saying that we saw that we are sharing pretty much the same challenges, although we are from Vermont to Israel and to Austria, so it's many different parts of the world. And also that our success factors have very much in common, and that the challenges that we face, they are not so much different than before the UN Convention was ratified. And so our message is that we have to work on closing this implementation gap, and we for ourselves, we want to like further expand the approaches that work, and we also see the necessity to work at policy level, because in Austria, for example, we have a legal framework that is really a big barrier for persons with intellectual disability to approach the labor market. Thank you.
Well, thank all of you for your engagement, for your PowerPoints, and for your discipline. We are really on time. And I think everybody welcomes individual questions. If somebody wants to approach us, please come. And thank you for that session, and thank Zero Project for giving us a chance to discuss that important project. Have a nice afternoon. Thank you.
Thank you.